visiting the London Motor Show first on BBC Two in Top Gear.
Welcome to the London Motor Show, your chance to come and make rational decisions about sensible family saloons that you'll be buying next year. Or, let's be honest, your chance to come and drool over shiny new supercars, like the 911. Picking up where a classic left off was never going to be easy, so Porsche hasn't been too radical. The new engine may be cooled by water instead of air, but they still put it right back here. The new car may be lower and wider than the old one, but it's still very definitely a 911, as is the price. 65,000. Ooh, a 911 interior where I can see all the dials and switches. And I'd love to be able to tell you what this is like to drive, but I can't, because I haven't. Tiff has, though, and he'll be doing just that in a couple of weeks.
And no visit to a British motor show would be the same without a peek at the Aston Martin stand. And new for this year is their V8 convertible, the Volante. It will cost you £169,500 of your pounds. But apparently, there is no shortage of takers. Production is up 25% due to a thumping economy and all those lottery winners. But if your numbers don't come up this Saturday, we can offer a crumb of comfort. Tiff Nadell is testing a little something that's just as quick, but doesn't require the handbag of the Duke of Westminster.
But it's been a great publicity stunt for the first of Honda's Type R series to reach the shores of Europe. What really matters, though, is what this, the road-going version, is like. And the secret to its success lies under the bonnet. This is Honda's latest version of their famous VTEC engines. Now, what VTEC stands for is Variable Valve Timing Electronically Controlled, or something like that, and other manufacturers do it, but only Honda produce an engine that actually changes the cam profile. Now, what this in effect does is to give you two different engines. Below 5,800 revs, you've got a 130 horsepower shopping engine. Above 5,800 revs, you've got a rocket ship with 190 horsepower. You see, what it does, as you go over 5.8, the cam profile... No, forget it. I'll show you what it does.
Oh! 5,000 revs, 35 miles an hour, second gear, we're going shopping. Open the throttle. Hear that engine change, and we're going to the moon! Gear, 8,500 revs, 80 miles an hour. The acceleration just goes on and on, and this is only a 1.8 litre engine. In fact, the only real big disappointment with this Integra, especially as it's a Type R, is that it hasn't got the more fashionable 6-speed gearbox. And in fact, 70 miles an hour, 5th gear is 4,000 revs, which can be rather tiresome on a long motorway cruise.
This car isn't for motorway cruising, it's for mean street cruising. 0-60 in 6.7 seconds with the rev counter reading 6,200 in third. It won't quite out-drag competition like the Fiat Coupe, but that relies on 2 litres and a turbocharger.
Turbocharger. engine that impresses because there's handling to match. This car almost redefines front wheel drive grip. Gone are the old days of torque steer. This just grips and goes. There's no tugging through the steering wheel. It doesn't spoil your driving enjoyment. This almost feels like a rear-wheel drive car, but it's got the grip as well. Third gear, turn in. Oh. But such performance must have good brakes, and this Integra has got NSX discs and superb ABS.
On sale at the end of the year, only a few hundred are due to be imported, and they'll all be white and cost around 23 grand.
Of course, it is a shame that the styling isn't a bit more exciting, that the dashboard isn't a bit more imaginative, that you get a kiddie's clock that seems to read 1888 all the time, and that some marketing twonk has taken out the air conditioning and the radio. But you do get two gorgeous red Recaro seats, and it's a blitz to drive. I just can't wait to try the Civic Type R, the Prelude Type R, the Accord Type R. Ah, yes, and the NSX Type R.
But lots of people have found it remarkably easy to wait for the launch of the new Lexus GS300. This is the SE version, and it's got, well, it's got absolutely everything, and all for the cost of a bonnet hinge on an S-Class Mercedes. Back in the States, the GS is as popular with Bible Belt bank managers as it is with Los Angeles-based gangster rappers. And it doesn't just look like another old Mercedes. It looks like a new Mercedes. Lexus have never quite managed to establish themselves here in the way that they might have wanted or expected to. And maybe, just maybe, that's because, at the end of the day, it's a big Corolla.
Tailoring a car to suit the United States usually means that it'll be absolutely hopeless over here. Americans, you see, are different to us. They like man-made fibres. They like a car that's half car, half blancmange. They like the Cadillac Seville. And now they're going to sell it to us with right-hand drive. Let's start with the good news. The 4.6-litre V8 engine is absolutely astonishing. It's smooth, it's powerful, it has 100,000-mile service intervals, and you can even run it through a desert with no water, which should come in handy in the West Midlands. Right, now for the bad news. I drove one of these cars in Arizona earlier this year, and it was simply ghastly. The handling was dreadful and the steering was more vague than Hugh Grant. Now, they say they've changed the one that's coming over to Britain, and I do hope so, or this will be the biggest American flop since Vietnam. Oh, and it isn't the only American car coming over here. Chevrolet is set to introduce the Corvette, which Quentin likes, but I don't. The Camaro, which Steve likes, but I don't. And the big, chunky four-wheel drive Blazer, which no one likes, except me. Anyway, that's enough on American left-hand drive cars, and over now to Quentin, who's gone mad.
And I'm rather partial to Ulrika Johnson, but that has nothing to do with anything apart from the fact that she is Swedish, and so is Volvo, who continue to surprise us. This is their new S40 T4, £20,000 worth. What you do is you take a standard S40, you breathe on it rather heavily, and then when you exhale, you have a 148-mile-an-hour motorized airbag that's almost as good as the BMW 328, only around £6,000 cheaper. And in Germany, there is another brand that's had a serious image invigoration of late, Audi. People are deserting BMWs and piling into these. This is the new S4 Quattro, which has not one turbocharger, but two. Top speed is limited to 155 miles an hour, and it has more torque than a BMW M3. Yours for £36,000, but dealers are reporting they've already sold that allocation, and there is now a waiting list. So, if you're lucky enough to have your name down for one of these, when you come to sell, you could be looking at making yourself a very agreeable pot of tea. Mind you, the market is stiff with opposition, and the very latest comes from the land of fettuccine.
In 1992, Alfa Romeo launched the 155, a saloon with a racing heart. Equipped with a unique twin-spark engine and superb handling, Alfa was sure they had a winner. Unfortunately, they forgot one important thing.
Style. When you buy a car, especially when it's an Alfa, you want it to look good. Now, the 155 didn't, but the 156 does.
Everything about the saloon says coupé. The short business-like tail, the shallow windows, the low profile. They've even tried to hide the fact that it's a four-door.
Yes, a four-door. There are back doors here, but they've cunningly hidden the door handle to keep the line smooth, and they're,
It would be impossible to mistake this car for anything other than an Alfa Romeo. The whole car appears to flow from the distinctive V-shaped Alfa grille, for which even the bumper has had to take a bow.
See, there it is, hidden in the C-pillar. Easy when you know how. Damn clever these Italians.
Alfa are gambling almost everything on the 156. They admit that this is the most important car in the company's history. They'll produce more of these than any other model they've ever made, and are hoping to see an awful lot of these stylish noses on Britain's roads. So who's going to buy this slinky saloon with a coupe complex?
Well, amazingly, Alfa are pitching the 156 as direct competition for the BMW 3 Series and the Audi A4, which is, to say the least, very brave.
And when you consider that Alfa only ever managed to sell about 900 155s each year in Britain, while in 1996 BMW sold 42,000 of their 3 Series, you have to wonder if they realise the enormity of the challenge ahead. When the 156 goes on sale in the new year, prices will range from just over 16,000 for the basic 1.8 up to 22,000 for the 2.5 V6. But it's the 2-litre model equipped, like the 1.8, with Alfa's splendid twin-spark engine that they expect to be the most popular.
Inside, it really is just gorgeous. As soon as you sit in, you know it's really something special. I like the dials, I like the steering wheel, I think the driving position's great. I'm not keen on this rather curious console here. It's very clear to look at, but why put that mock wood on? It just simply doesn't need it. It looks like plastic because it is plastic.
But the rest of it looked as if build quality and reliability has moved from the bottom to the top of Alfa's agenda. Knobs and switches feel firm and solid to the touch, and I spent many a happy hour fiddling and faffing to see if they'd stand up to day-to-day abuse. The verdict? Well, only time will really tell.
But of course, it's not enough to just look like a sports car. It's also got to act like one. And with an Alfa Romeo twin-spark engine in, well, it lives up to its reputation.
Alfa's racing pedigree is reflected in the handling. Cornering and braking are controlled and positive. Acceleration isn't earth-shattering, but despite appearances to the contrary, it is a saloon after all.
This car is undoubtedly a bona fide member of the modern Italian school of styling, and it does offer you a great badge for your key. But perhaps it would have been better if the 156 had been aimed at the less prestigious end of the saloon car market. I'd take bets that the Alfa Romeo name will tempt more people away from the Mondeo and the Vectra than it will from the BMW or the Audi.
Now, don't let anybody tell you that all this shiny metal is blameless and fault-free, because it's not. In last year's Top Gear JD Power customer satisfaction survey, you told us that cars like the Land Rover Discovery, the Vauxhall Frontera, and the Ford Escort were nothing short of perambulating disasters. Last year, you told us that the Japanese make the best cars. Now, whether you agree with that or not doesn't matter. What matters is it gives you a chance to have your say, to tell the motoring mandarins exactly what you think of their cars. And believe you me, they do take notice. Every time the word JD Power is mentioned, they reach for the Valium. Now, this year, we need your help again. We're on the lookout for N-plate cars. That's those registered between August the 1st, 1995, and July the 31st, 1996. Doesn't matter what car it is, we need to hear from you. So all you have to do is dial this number, 0800 99 1111. It won't cost you a brass farthing and we will send you a questionnaire. And if you didn't get that number down, don't worry, we will repeat it at the end of the programme just for you. And the motor mandarins aren't just looking forward, they're looking backward too. The whole industry, it seems, is getting into retro. Everybody is trying to create a bit of bloodline because they know that heritage sells cars. And if you want the real thing with a bit of good old honest patina, there's even a classic car auction here as well.
We're holding four sales and it incorporates everything from popular classics right up to important collector's cars. We have an MGB found by a gentleman in the north of England. He paid £200 for it, totally restored it. We reckon about £10,000 to £12,000. For those who want the specialist car, there's the 1926 Bentley. It's the 3-litre short chassis model with the boat-tailed coachwork. Excellent, probably in the region of £120,000 to £140,000. And for those of you on a lesser budget, Johnny Herbert's pit bike. 1989, Team Lotus, great for commuting around the city. £1,200 to £1,400 perhaps, great piece of history. To have some
dreaming. Right, I'm here on the Rover stand looking for the new Mini, which they showed to the Germans at the Frankfurt show a couple of weeks ago, but it doesn't appear to be here. They've brought along the old Mini, of course, but I think it's safe to assume that we've all seen that before. Or have we?
To demonstrate that there's still some life left in the 40-year-old relic, Rover has taken pretty much every luxury item found in any car anywhere in the world and shoved them in this. The Mini limousine therefore has air-conditioned seats, a handcrafted Mini disc system, and satellite navigation.
This is all very impressive, but I've seen customised Minis before. What I have not seen before is a Mini quite like that. It looks ordinary, I'll grant you, but an anonymous European customer has just paid £50,000 for it. £50,000. That's about that much. It even has an ordinary Mini engine. Well, ordinary-ish. You see, this one has 1.4 litres, 16 valves, twin overhead camshafts. The results are spectacular. This Mini develops 160 horsepower.
With straight cut gears. No idea what that means, but I'll tell you this, it's about as refined as a battlefield. Oh, then there's the steering. We've all driven the go-karts, we know how responsive they are. Well, this is nothing like that. It's much, much better. To 60 in about 5 seconds in a Mini.
However, there are one or two problems. I'm afraid it isn't terribly comfortable in the same way that rodeo riding isn't terribly comfortable. You don't run down the road in this, you hop. I have to say also, it's a tad loud. There are no carpets, no sound insulation. You're bombarded with the screech of its gearbox and the nuclear ferocity of its engine. After prolonged use, your ears will start to bleed. It occurs to me that you can achieve the same effect as this car for rather less than £50,000. You climb into a metal box with a pile driver, start it up and ask someone to push you off a cliff. Do I like this car? Yes. Do I want one? And no. And not even a little bit.
New cars needn't be exciting, and here are three of them. If you were Vauxhall, you wouldn't just be hoping that the new Astra is a success, you would be praying they've invested £300 million in it. Still, unlike some of the new cars here at Earls Court, this one genuinely is new. The engine, floor pan, suspension and body all debut on this model. In celebration of such stunning originality, they've styled it to look almost identical to the one it replaces and given it a snappy new name. Astra. With the Zara, Citroën have asked us to look beyond the obvious. What? Like a name that people can actually pronounce? Prices start at just under £12,000 and finish at just over £17,000. For now though, it's only available in five-door form. But there is an estate and this hot little VTS version in the offing. All cars have an engine and four wheels, obviously. And there's a new Golf, but not so as you'd notice. Still, Volkswagen would undoubtedly argue that they, above anyone, understand the customer in this most thoroughly conservative sector of the market. And what that customer wants is their old Golf, except a little bit better. The original Golf was so radical. This car seems so reactionary. Still, we'll be able to tell you more when we've actually driven it. Or we'll be doing that later in the series.
But among all this gleaming metal is something the car makers don't want you to know. They can't get rid of it all. They are making cars faster than they can sell them. And the airfields of Britain are littered with the evidence. Around 1 in 20 of the 2 million new cars leaving factory gates in the UK every year don't get sold as new. It's the curse of the industry, and it is called oversupply.
The production lines are set up to produce a particular fixed volume of vehicles that the financial people have preordained is the break-even point, and at which point we can begin to make profit. Once that financial planning has started, it is very difficult to switch it off again. You get oversupplied, so that's the problem.
So what happens to all this unsold, orphaned metal? Well, it gets sold to large companies, 500 at a time, up to 40% discount. They go to leasing companies, rental companies, hire companies, they become courtesy cars. Manufacturers will even register huge blocks and then sell them on as second-hand cars. It sounds crazy, and it is. And let me just tell you, on the last day of August, the 31st, over 80,000 cars were registered in a single day. And I will bet you that only a handful of those were ever even seen by a private buyer. Take the Ford Cab. Ford reckoned they would sell cotchels of them, but so far they've only managed to ship 23,000 this year, which is why they're offering 0% finance and £99 down. The same story applies to the Nissan Micra. The market just won't absorb the huge numbers being churned out. And the Peugeot 106 is suffering too. Why do you think Peugeot are running all those TV and billboard ads for 106 special editions? And it's a malady that is affecting most of the European-built volume cars. The consumer is becoming more choosy, we're all keeping our cars longer, and we're not being taken in by all that daft August the 1st nonsense anymore.
For the consumer, in the short and medium term, it's an excellent thing. The deals you can get for new cars will be excellent, and nearly new cars. And it will get better still.
So the good news for you and me is that while the manufacturers continue to shoot themselves in both feet, there are more cars and more choice than ever before. So if you are about to buy a mainstream family new car, go into that showroom and negotiate with your boots on. Hold your head up high, confident in the knowledge that there are more cars than there are buyers. The manufacturer's loss is your gain.
Oversupply certainly isn't a problem for Britain's small but persistent army of specialist car makers. Now, the limelight is normally hogged by TVR, but on this occasion, I thought it would be a good idea to have a look at AC, Britain's oldest surviving car maker. Obviously, they're best known for the Cobra, which is here with a new supercharged engine. But the big news is this Ace. It's available for the first time with a hard top, new interior, more horsepower, and a carbon fibre bonnet. The price has gone up to a whopping £75,000, but it's a nice car. Smooth. Stylish.
Ford are perhaps not the first car company you would associate with a word like style. However, they do have a habit of taking cobbled together concept cars and sticking them in a remarkably short space of time on suburban driveways, like they did with the car.
Ford haven't been coy carping on about the car, although this one seems to be suffering from a leaky sunroof. Still, with all that water on board, it should handle like a tank. Back on terra firma, the MC2 concept, known as the Cougar in the States, is a pointer towards a Mondeo-sized coupe that will be with us next year. As such, it incorporates lots of things that are good about Ford's snappily titled New Edge design, like these rearview mirrors and this groovy louvered roof, and some things that aren't quite so good. Like this space 1999 style interior.
Suede.
They say that the 4x4 has had its day, that the MPV, much more in tone with Blair's Britain, has stolen away all of its supporters. So why is it you can't move for the things here? And it doesn't matter if you've not got a new one, you can just rejig an old one, like Nissan have done with the Patrol. They say it's got an all-new exterior and an all-new interior, although this one obviously hasn't, hence the blacked-out windscreen. What that really means is it looks a bit different on the outside, a bit different on the inside, but underneath, all the important bits are more or less the same as the last one. Similarly, Toyota's RAV4 has a trendy new set of clothes, and that should be just about enough to keep it at the head of its class. Like a pair of Vivienne Westwood platforms, the Isuzu V-Cross is intended to impress, but you can actually buy it. However, like the skyscraping shoes, I feel that its appeal will be limited. Previous Daihatsu 4x4s have been agricultural. The Terios is entirely more urban, but it may be just a bit too cute and cuddly for its own good. Think of it as a Yorkshire Terios. Ferrari don't build 4x4s. Lamborghini used to, but they cost about £1 million a go. But don't despair, because the funkiest 4x4 by far is with us. It's called the Land Rover Freelander, and it combines tough enough street styling with the rugged off-road ability of a Land Rover. This is the 1.8 XEI softback, 18,600 on the road, and another £3,000 for all these extra shiny bits. But of course, the thing about motor shows and motor cars is that you can't drive them!
Well, that's what he thinks. You see, just outside Hall 2, they've built this enormous off-road course. It's got a lake, it's got a mountain. It's so big, they say it's going to take 900 man-hours to dismantle. Not after he's been around it, it won't.
So, why don't you like the Corvette?
It's horrible.
Why is it horrible?
It's just so ugly and you called it a supercar.
It is a supercar. It's 172 miles an hour, 0-60 in under 5 seconds. What do you want? Corvette is a fine car. I know the reason why you don't like it, because it's American and you don't like Americans because they're all fat and they wear check trousers and have too many rules and laws.
They don't understand how to make sports cars. Pedal on the right. Come on. Quicker, 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 quicker. So, there we are, the Ssangyong...
Coriander, colander...
Colander. Any good?
Very nice.
Very nice, apparently.
Next week, there's a larger-than-usual helping of motoring on the BBC. On Sunday, there's more delights from the motor show over on BBC One, starting at 4:30 for a whole 50 minutes. Then, on Monday night, Quentin's at it again on BBC Two with a celebration of the Mini. In his Cars the Star. And Top Gear's back to normal on Thursday when I get to drive some serious cars which just happen to have their steering wheels on the wrong side. Finally, a reminder of that number if you want to take part in our JD Power survey. It's 0800 99 11 11. Remember, we're looking for N registered cars only and the calls will be free.